Je t'aime, te amo, ya te alabu. Oni on heaven on earth, I love you. Sounds are all as different as the lands from which they came. Though our words are all unique, our hearts are still the same. Love in any language, straight from the heart, pulls us all together, never apart. And once we learn to speak it, all the world will hear. Love in any language, fluently spoken here. We teach the young our differences, yet look how we're the same. Love to laugh, to dream our dreams, we know the sting of pain. From Leningrad to Lexington, the farmer loves his land. Daddies all get misty-eyed to give their daughters hand. Maybe when we realize how much there is to share, find too much in common to pretend it isn't there. Love in any language, straight from the heart, pulls us all together, never apart. And once we learn to speak it, all the world will hear. Love in any language, fluently spoken here. Through the rhetoric of government may keep our worlds apart, there's no misinterpreting the language of heart. Love in any language, straight from the heart, pulls us all together, never apart. And once we learn to speak it, all the world will hear. Love in any language, fluently spoken here. Love in any language, straight from the heart, never apart. We speak it, we'll hear that. Love in any language, fluently spoken here. Love in and once we learn to speak it, all the world will hear. Love in any language, fluently spoken here.
Truly, love in every language is spoken here. Thank you, Cinnamon, and welcome to Benevola Church, friends, family, and those who are here. I am Pastor Suzanne Jones. It's a pleasure to welcome you here this morning and to worship with you on the second Sunday in Advent. If you have yourself a bulletin, Advent, good Lord, I need to wake up. It's Lent. It's purple everywhere, right? Goodness gracious. It is Lent as we prepare ourselves for Easter. Glad you're paying attention. Well, if you pay attention inside of your bulletin, there are some announcements inside of there that could bring your attention to. Just a list of different activities that are going on this week and things that we're going to be preparing for later in this month or even in this next coming few weeks. Especially with our Lenten season, we have Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday, and of course, our Easter services. Our Easter services will be 6:30 in the morning for a sunrise service up at the pavilion, and then here at worship at 9 o'clock. And we'll have coffee and donuts in between the services so you can come and fellowship with us. But we also have a Monday, Thursday service that we will be hosting as a community. Other churches in the South County, Washington area will be coming over here, and we will be having a soup and sandwich dinner and then a service of hand washing for our Monday, Thursday service, as well as a little communion in that as well. There are other announcements in there. Is anything that I need to vocally lift up this morning? Anybody want to lift up anything this morning? Don't think there's any. Miss Connie.
I just need to spotlight.
Oh, spotlight. Wonderful, wonderful. Longevity Fit starting at 4 o'clock on Mondays and Wednesdays. And then after Longevity Fit is Body and Soul, the High Aerobics Fit, and that's at 5:30. So really great time to move the body and try it out. So thank you for sharing with that, Connie. Anything else? Yes, Ruth. Fantastic. Absolutely. We get to hear a little bit from Brett's voice. And Brett, we're looking forward to supporting you out there at the Potomac Playmakers. Go see a great show. And you can reserve tickets online at the Potomac Playmakers website. Or you can go talk to Brett and he might have a little information for you too. So great to go and support our local theaters as well as those who are participating. Anything else this morning? Well, let us get into our worship this morning together. So let us stand as we are able and let us share in this call to worship together. We are in it for the long haul. Our God is an everlasting God. From the beginning to the end, Alpha and Omega, we know that God is with us now and always. When life is difficult, we know God's presence through the love of one another. Trust in God and lean into the love of your neighbors. Focus your hearts and minds in this time of worship. For in all things, in all times, we shall praise the Lord. Let us praise the Lord our God on page 598 in our red hymnals. We'll sing verses 1 and 4.
Thank you.
us bring our joys and our concerns together as a community and lift one another up in spirit and in prayer. I'd like to invite prayers for the Gudgeon family. Lori Gudgeon passed away this week, and she had cancer for a little more than 6 years, and she went into hospice care earlier this month, and she has gone to be with the Lord. And I just ask for your prayers for her family and those who are grieving this day. Are there others that we can lift up this morning? Yes, Ruth. We will continue to keep Ireland Tackett in prayer as he's awaiting for the next step in his process, hoping to get the heart rate down a little bit so that way he can go into his next surgery. But we'll keep him covered in prayer. Thanks for lifting that up. Others this morning? Yes, Becky. Yes. We want to keep Marta and Eric in our prayers, continued prayers. Not so good news came out this week, a recurrence of his cancer, and I just ask that you continue to pray for Eric and the family and as we come alongside in support. Ruyan.
On a happy note, Pastor Suzanne has had her birthday on Wednesday, and
yes.
I'll be happy to tell you how old she
is. I'm happy for you to tell them too. Why not?
Four.
Yes. Oh, no, you don't have to sing. Thank you. Sound like the restaurant. Appreciate that. And all those who are also celebrating birthdays too, happy birthday to you all as well. But certainly mine's better. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. And it is, don't look at Jeff, geez. And it's so good to see you this morning. Go telling stories in church. It's good to see you, Ed, in church here, and so glad that you're able to be out and about, and we'll continue to keep you in prayer as your next processes are going through in your therapy. But it's good to have you in worship today. Yes, Gail. Absolutely. I will continue to lift up prayers for Jim Whitman and Kathy as he's recovering, but also for Rod Klein and his family as he's undergoing a lung disorder and they're trying to help assist him with that. So we'll keep those in our prayers. Cindy.
Ask Porter what he did yesterday.
Porter, what did you do yesterday? He got first place in Destination Imagination. Congratulations, Porter. That's awesome. Along with Haley as well, or Bailey. Bailey as well was in that as well. Oh, congratulations to you and to your team. That's fantastic news.
There was this kid that went to
Oh, so they went to Ellicott City to compete in this Destination Imagination program, and they came out on top. Woohoo! We're proud of them and all their accomplishments. Yes, Tom. Donnie Thomas family. We will keep the Donnie Thomas family in prayer at this time. Thank you, Tom, for lifting that. And yes, Eileen. Amen. We'll continue to keep Leah in our prayers as she's going under this last radiation treatment. And hopefully things will work out for her best there. We continue prayers for you all. Yes. Yes, Brett. George? Brent. Brent. Your best friend Brent is prepping for surgery right now, and we're going to keep him in prayer, Brent in prayer. Well, with that, oh, there's one more, Cinnamon.
Just keep Mom in your prayers.
Yes. Absolutely. Carol is going to be undergoing cataract surgery for the other eye, and we will keep you in prayer, Carol, as you go through that. Indeed. Well, lots of things to keep on our hearts, but also we can lift these all up to the Lord, because there's many of things that have not been spoken aloud. So let us take this time to talk with God. Would you bow your heads with me? Oh, Lord God, you give us another day today to gather in your name, to gather as your children. And you draw us close, Lord. And we thank you. We thank you for your love and for your mercy that meets us here. We get to experience your love in many different ways. And we thank you for every good gift that comes from you. During this season of Lent, we reflect upon our lives and know that we have this incredible need for you. Especially with everything that is going on in our lives and in our world. But Lord, we also have an incredible need for forgiveness. We need your forgiveness for every sin and mistake that we've made, for every fear that we have, for every uncertainty that bubbles up inside of us. We know we need you, God. And we offer to you our prayer of confession. We have missed the mark. And we offer you words of humble and simple spirit. Forgive us, Lord. We acknowledge that we are dust, and to dust we shall return. But Lord, before we ever ask, you offer your forgiveness. You offer your grace and your mercy. And we thank you. We are undeserving, but you called us beloved. And you welcome us in. As we seek to connect with you, God, we know that we offer our prayers, and we know you hear every word. Those prayers that are spoken and those that are not spoken. You hear our cries for those who have lost loved ones, for those who are grieving this day, for those who are awaiting results, for those who are in the middle of waiting, period. We pray for those who are in relationships that are struggling. We pray for medical doctors and nurses and teachers and decision makers. And we pray for our leaders who are helping serve in the ways they can, and they lay their lives down for others. Lord, we pray for this community that is in need of your comfort and your love. God, you hear our prayer. You hear our celebrations. You hear our pain. And as long as we share our hearts with you, we pray that you would help heal them and help heal our minds and our body and our spirit. Heal us so that we may be sent to offer hope and healing in the name of Jesus. And when we're at loss for words, we pray together the prayer that your Son taught his disciples to pray. We lift up our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as you feel comfortable, I invite you to share the peace with one another by greeting your neighbor and saying, "The peace of the Lord be with you." Take this time to share the peace, and I'll invite the children to come forward for kids' time today.
Good morning. Good morning. Did you see all the pretty quilts around here today?
Yeah.
We've been busy again. We put a note in the bulletin today that says that we've been doing this for 10 years and we've made 400 quilts.
That's a lot of blankets.
Wow, that's a lot of blankets. They've gone to all kinds of different places.
Yeah.
Today, though, we've got something different. Do you know what else I have? What's this? A bag. Yeah, do you know it's looked like it's got stuff in it. Is it made? That's a good question. Do you know what these are made out of? They're made out of, I wrote it down because I knew I would forget. Upholstery samples.
Upholstery
samples.
What are those?
Those are, if you go to a store and you want to buy new curtains, they have pieces of cloth that you can look at that show you what you might be buying. So Miss Irene had a huge bag of upholstery samples, and I turned them into bags.
Wow.
I wonder why I made bags. Did you know that we have a grocery store here at church? You didn't know that? Do you know why we have a grocery store at church? It's called Katie's Cupboard. And we remember Miss Katie, because Miss Katie started Katie's Cupboard. And she thought there are some people that don't have enough money to go to the grocery store. and we could have a grocery store here at church. And then they could come here, and they wouldn't have to pay anything to get their groceries. And so we have a grocery store here at church. And sometimes those folks don't have a bag to put their stuff in when they come to the grocery store. And so I made a whole bunch of bags for Miss Katie's cupboard. So today we're going to dedicate those bags too, because they need some bags to be able to put their groceries in when they come shopping at Katie's cupboard. So we have quilts that are probably going to go to Sleep in Heavenly Peace, where we've given some quilts before. We also have some quilts. Sometimes somebody makes the top of a quilt and they never get it finished, and we end up with it. And so we finish it. And so we've got a couple quilts that were actually made by hand. They instead of using just a sewing machine, they made them by hand. These two here on the end, right next to the cross, were made by hand, and they never got finished. And so we finished them off. So not all of these tops got made by the ladies that come on Tuesday mornings. But we're always happy to have other people come and join us on Tuesday mornings. Every Tuesday morning, we're here. So we're going to let Pastor Suzanne help us bless the bags and the quilts this morning.
Yes, so we're going to pray a special prayer over them. And if you would like to, you can find a quilt or a bag. If you want to get up and find a quilt or a bag and maybe put your hands on it, okay? So go ahead and stand up. Stand up and find a quilt or a bag. And yeah, you're right there with it, Teddy. You can find one. There's some along the edge there. And adults, I invite you too to, you can reach out your hand or just be in an attitude of prayer there. Make sure Miss Quinn gets one over there. Does she got one? Okay, she's got one. Good. All right, everybody. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Let's bow our heads and pray. Dear God, we thank you for the quilting ministry here at Benevola United Methodist Church. We pray that these quilts and these shopping bags will be used to share your love and glory with others. May the people who receive them receive warmth and comfort and also utility, Lord. May these bags be filled with precious items and things that will help sustain our brothers and sisters in Christ in their life. Lord, we thank you for the hands that have made and stitched each one of these items, and we ask that you continue to bless this ministry as we can bless our community with these items. It's in Jesus' name we pray over these things and dedicate them to you. Amen. All right, guys, thanks so much for joining us this morning. Go to kids' time or to your parents. They already know where to go. That's a good thing. And Becky is our lay reader today, and she will share with us the scripture this morning.
Each bag has about 10 more bags inside of it.
Wow. You've been busy.
I've been busy.
Yeah. It's called the
Hind Factory. The Hind Factory, yes. Our scripture today is from Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Jesus predicts his death. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer these things, and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But then Jesus turned and looked at the disciples, and he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." The way of the cross. And then he called the crowd to him, along with the disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny himself and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in the adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory and with the holy angels. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will you bow your heads with me and pray? Holy God, we give you thanks for the gift of the word that you've given us today, and help us to take this word and write it upon our hearts. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. So one good thing about being a February birthday kid is that it's also in the season of Girl Scout cookie season. Right? Well, I mean, the season kind of excludes a couple. But did you know that it is still currently Girl Scout cookie season? Maybe you have had somebody in your life ask you if you'd like to place an order, or maybe you've seen them out at the stores with their tables or anything like that. And let's face it, when I say Girl Scout cookies, you know what I mean, right? All of us have our favorite Girl Scout cookies. I like all of them. But, you know, parents are happy to share with others at the office that their child is selling these cookies, and they want to help support the children's troops and all the different troops in the area. And, you know, the Girl Scouts been selling cookies since 1922, which is remarkable that it's continuing to serve this day. And they started selling their cookies for about 35 cents a dozen. And these cookies, actually, even though they've grown in price and they've shrunk in size, how does that happen? But these cookies are legendary. And really, they sell themselves, right? I don't have to say much about them. It's one thing to sell cookies and support young girls in their mission to build girls of courage, confidence, and character to make the world a better place. That's their mission statement. But it's another thing to sell the message that Jesus was selling. Oh, did I just put Girl Scout cookies and Jesus in the same sentence? Yes. We're more apt to sell one than the other. Especially the sales pitch that Jesus has for us. And that sales pitch is, take up your cross and follow me. Take up your cross for the sake of the gospel. Lose your life for me. I'll tell you what, it's easier to consume a Girl Scout cookie than it is to do that. I think many of us would rather tell people about the Girl Scouts or scouting in general, and to celebrate them than to celebrate Jesus and what Jesus calls us to do. It's hard to do that. It's an easier conversation to have with others, that's for sure. It's easy to offer that kind of support, but why is it so hard to live for the sake of the gospel and tell others about Jesus? Why is it that we wrestle with it? I don't see many people wrestling with putting a cookie in their mouth. I know I don't. I just pop it right in, even though I know I'm not supposed to. But why do we wrestle with the message that Jesus has for us? To deny ourselves, to take up our cross. In our 21st century culture, taking up a cross means making an active choice to live into the ministry that God calls us to do, knowing full well that it will cost you something. It costs you a lifestyle change. It costs you a conversation or maybe a relationship. It might even cost you your time. Heaven forbid it costs you a Sunday morning for an hour. It might cost you your life. Jesus says, There it goes.
For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. You will lose your life. Let that sink in for a minute. I know it's pretty deep on a Sunday morning, but yeah. You will lose your life. In seminary, I had to read a book called In His Steps by Charles Sheldon. In fact, I was fortunate to have this book given to me even before I went into seminary from Roger Bertner. He gave it to me and he inscribed it to Suzanne and Jeff with love, Roger and Sylvia. And of course, with his passing, I just couldn't help but to bring this book out again and to read over it and all the places that I have underlined and all the stuff that I had to write about in seminary about this book too. And if you haven't read it or heard about this book, it's actually a story that centers on what happens when a pastor and his church take a pledge for a year to follow in Jesus' steps. The characters are asked, what would Jesus do in every life situation that they have occurring in their outside lives of church? For example, one of the characters, he's the town newspaper editor, Edward Norman, and he printed in his paper only things that Jesus would print in his paper if he had one. Norman printed only what Jesus would. He excluded summaries of violent sporting events, of any mention of tobacco or alcohol advertisements. And he actually stopped production of his newspaper on Sundays. Now, despite the paper's failing profits, Norman continued to reform his business practices by paying for the paper himself until a fellow Christian at his church, Virginia Page, donated some money towards the cause. Now, another character, Alexander Powers, he's a manager of a prominent company. It's actually the train company that comes in, the railroading company that comes in, who brought lots of jobs to the town. However, what Mr. Powers discovers is that the company is using unethical business practices to uphold his pledge of what would Jesus do. Powers actually resigns from his position, which caused him to face major financial and social consequences for his family. Now, that's just two of the characters. There's a lot more that goes on in this book. I didn't give you all the details because you need to read it. But even though this book was set in the early 19th century, these themes still run true today. These fictional characters experienced suffering when Jesus came in, when they were asked to follow in the steps of Jesus, of what would Jesus do? It is the kind of suffering we experience when we take up the cross and we live for the sake of the gospel. Could you imagine a company this day and age closed on a Sunday and still doing well in business? I can think of one right now, and if I'm making you hungry for lunch, sorry, got to wait till tomorrow to go to Chick-fil-A, right? And Hobby Lobby's another one. There are several that are doing that for the sake of their principles. Could you imagine a newspaper or a news media outlet with no violent stories, with no bad news to share? Or leaving a high-profile job because you have an ethical disagreement with it. Yeah, sure, the paycheck looks great, but really, is it worth it? In the book, the main characters recognize their selfishness and their willful disregard for those less fortunate, and their actions actually produce a transforming chain, and these events impact the town and beyond. And they made a choice to live
for the sake of the gospel. How many of us can say we live for the sake of the gospel? You know, it is easy to listen to the voice that tells you not to speak to somebody about Jesus or not to invite someone to church. That voice will try to convince you that talking about your faith in a personal way, you know, that might offend somebody, so you're not going to say anything. In fact, we have companies and institutions that have instilled rules that we can't speak about our faith. And to that I say, whatever. That voice will try to tell you, don't get yourself embarrassed. You're going to say something that you don't mean. You risk humiliation. Why are you going to talk about something you don't know? Do we have those voices in our minds and in our hearts? Absolutely. There are things we wrestle with constantly. Look, if precious Girl Scouts can ask strangers if they want to purchase a box of cookies, I think we can ask people if they know Jesus or if they have experienced the gospel in some way. If we can tell others about sporting events and about what our grandchildren are up to and about what we watched on Netflix and the series that we watched the other day, then we can certainly tell others about God and how God is working in our lives. Jesus says, if anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when it comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels. But if you deny yourself so that you could follow Jesus, if you take up your cross, if you live for the sake of the gospel, then our lives will be transformed. And that is good news. Those who lose their life for Jesus' sake and for the sake of the gospel, what does the gospel say? It says it will be saved. We will be saved. We will be transformed. We will experience resurrection. That was something we talked about during our Bible study this week. What would happen if Mary Magdalene did not share her experience with resurrection? We'd be telling the story today. Now, suffering isn't the goal here. Jesus didn't come to earth for the sole purpose of dying and suffering on a cross, but the cross was an inevitable part of fulfilling that purpose. There's a difference. Christ's purpose was to bring and usher in the kingdom of God and overcoming death by rising from the dead. And the only way to resurrection is through the cross. It had to take place. The only way to new life for us is in the cross. So what does that mean for our church? What does it mean for you to take up your cross and to live for the sake of the gospel? Are you willing to take these words and share it with others out there? Maybe sharing your testimony and how Jesus' resurrection impacted your life. Ira Brent Driggers, he wrote, for the Gospel of Mark, discipleship is not some comfortable affiliation with Jesus, but a life-changing and potential life-threatening commitment to him. I love that. It's risky to follow Jesus. It's not a commitment to an idea or a set of beliefs. It's a commitment to a person. That person's name is Jesus Christ, God incarnate. And I'm here to tell you, it's a commitment worth making, because when you give your life to Christ, when you decide to live for the sake of the gospel, when you follow in his steps, it will cost you everything. It will go against the grain of everything. But you will find your purpose in the meantime. You will find meaning, and your life will have meaning because of the gospel. So I ask you, will you take up your cross? And will you follow Jesus and tell others about Jesus for the sake of the gospel? May we do so this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us take our time here to absorb this and how we are living for the gospel in the different ways that we have. As we invite our ushers to come forward to collect our tithes and offering, to give back to God what God has so graciously given back to us, we give it with open and generous hearts.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me, Father? Did you?" They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before his hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Took from his head the thorny crown and wrapped him in a linen gown, then laid him to rest inside the tomb. The holes in his hands, his feet, and side. Now in our hearts we know he died to save us from ourselves. Oh, hallelujah. Days went by, again they came to move the stone, to bless the slain with oil and spice, anointing, hallelujah. But as they went to move the stone, they saw that they were not alone, for Jesus Christ has risen, hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
of goodness, we bring our gifts and our whole hearts. Strengthen us to carry our own cross and help others carry their crosses as well. In the name of the one who bore his cross for us, amen.
Amen. Let us close this morning with our last hymn in the Black Faith We Sing books. We'll sing verses 1 and 4 of Would I Have Answered When You Called. May Christ give you strength beyond your own so that you can go and share the good news of Christ's resurrection. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace to love and serve the Lord for the sake of the gospel. Amen.